There seems to be a consistent core of viewership here, and so I'm going to reward those viewers by giving you the very best stuff right away. And for new viewers, just hang in there. I will give sort of a basic orientation later in the video. But those who have been watching consistently already have a basic orientation and understanding of what this is about. So I want to get them going right off the bat. So this is sort of a new, something that's been pointed out to me, to reward those who are, you know, consistently viewing, is to address them first. Address them first. Okay, so new viewers, don't worry. I will go over all the basics as I do in every video at some point. But we're going to start out with the very advanced stuff here, okay? And we do have that. We do have that for you. Extraordinary breakthroughs. This morning, welcome to Memorial Day, May 25th, I believe, 2015. 2015 is a very significant year. I say it's the year that Jesus has returned to this world, has returned his attention, whether it's spirit or body, the attention is here. Okay. And the new dispensation, the new challenge is with us. And that's the challenge, is to finish the consideration that we started, have been engaged with for so long on this planet. Started 2020 years ago. Now, along with that, how do we finish? Okay, I've had an experience, a very significant experience, and I will share that with you. It started out, and this morning I was working as I woke up, sort of not sleeping very well, woke up and have been working on, you know, how can I finish my consideration here and accept truth as it is. And I found myself in this room, and someone came and slammed the door shut, you know, and said, "You're not leaving." I said, "You can't get out of here. You're not leaving." I said, "Wow, what do I do now? I'm trapped. And suddenly, all the walls of the house just flattened out. Like falling, fall this way. Everything just fell flat. And I found myself, I was still present, and I was free. I wasn't trapped in any room. Everything had just fallen flat. This was the beginning. And gradually, I began to focus on this and realize what had happened. And I realized the whole world is flat. Everything had flattened. Everything is flat. The whole world is flat. The whole universe is flat. All concepts are flat. All symbols are flat. Everything's flat. Everything flattened out. Everything flattened out. And yet, I remained, as if floating, as if present, above the flatness. So my awareness, my identity, my presence, what I am, was not flat. But all appearances, all ideas, all things, everything was flat. Time, space, process, and form had completely flattened out. It was just completely flat. This is what I was realizing. And I wasn't bothered by it at all. I wasn't frightened or bothered by it. I just said, "Wow, this is very interesting." So I'm somewhat in the wow mode still from this. Somewhat in the wow mode. As we understand, what we do here is we accelerate, then we coast. Accelerate and coast. We need to go fast. We know that. It's either we finish our consideration that we are equal to God, but we didn't establish equality with God. God did. Or we're going to slide or fall into tyranny. Fall into tyranny is one of the two. Either it's liberation or tyranny right now. That is for sure. There is no in between. Age of consideration is over. Now we must, it's the age of conclusion now. It's the age of concluding. Bring it to an end. And so I saw this flattening out happen, and I realized that this was what I've been looking for. And far from feeling dead or devastated, I wasn't at all. I was like, wow, this is great, I'm free. I can't be touched, I can't fall, everything's flat. How can I fall down, fall in flatland? There's no depth, there's nothing to fall into. How can I be trapped? There's nothing to be trapped to. Everything's flat. As flat as a pancake. Flatter than a pancake. Totally flat. Flat like a zero. Flat like a zero. So I'm sort of re-experiencing the wow of this experience, but I was fine. I was relaxed. I would just say, hey, this is quite interesting. I like this. I can say the world is flat finally, and I realize that something very interesting. I've always said that we're in a regressive time right now, very regressive. That the ancients, in a lot of ways. They weren't quite as arrogant as we are. And they saw the world as flat. That's very interesting. They saw the world as flat. They said, flat earth. And of course, now we say, well, it's a globe, of course. And those people were crazy, stupid. But I considered, you know what? Maybe it was a spiritual statement that they were making, that they were spiritually experiencing the world as flat. As far as in a spiritual way, okay, they're experiencing everything as flat in a spiritual way. They hadn't yet progressed in their arrogance, listening to the advice of arrogance, to the point where they're starting to see all this imaginary depth to things, to locations, to time, to all this, as if it has some sort of depth. It's actually entirely flat, totally flat. Flat, flat, flat. No depth to any of it. Complete sameness to all of it. Complete sameness to all of it. It's all flat. Not even one little peak. All the mountains are flat. All the valleys are flat. Everything is flat. From a spiritual standpoint. Now, I wonder, how did I get here? How did I get here to be able to see that, experience this, and see it, and I'm not bothered by it? And so I started to examine this, and obviously the answer is through right practice, right practice. The assertions that I've been doing, full stop in the wow practice, which is assertions, accelerate coast, accelerate coast, accelerate coast. It's working, it's working. This is what I have to say. Now, I'm in somewhat of a wow mode now, because this is really quite something to share with the world. So I'll coast a little bit here and there. Now, I had been told if I experienced this flatness like this, I'll die. Okay, I didn't die. I did not die. I've been told that if I experience this flatness, I'll suffer severe despair and depression. I did not suffer any despair or depression. I've been told if I experience this flatness like this, I will experience total mental chaos. I did not experience any mental chaos whatsoever. I just said, oh, this is good. I like this. So What is it that's been telling me that I would experience all, that this would be a complete disaster for me? What is it, what has been telling me this for so long? Arrogance, the logic of arrogance. The logic of arrogance concludes, reaches these conclusions. They're turned out to be completely false conclusions. Arrogance tells us that when we, if we experience this, we're going to have a, we're going to spiritually die. I did not spiritually die. Arrogance tells us that we're going to have no identity. I did not have no identity. Arrogance tells us we're going to have no presence, no awareness, no identity. None of that is true. None of that is true. In fact, it's arrogance and following the advice of arrogance that leads to ultimately total mental chaos, which you feel as if you have no awareness, no presence, and no identity. Even though you do, you're simulating total mental chaos. You simulate the lost. You're simulating spiritual death. It's arrogance, the advice of arrogance, that is advising us to simulate spiritual death. And we do this by trying to establish our equality with God instead of accepting that God established our equality. Okay, and how do we pursue the establishment of our own value, of our own equality with God? Through believing in imaginary depth of concepts, of process, of form, of time, space, process, and form. Imagining that this, that there's these pathways, that there's depth to it, and we, and that there's discovery is possible. Okay, discovery is possible. When you see it all flattened out, you realize there's no discovery possible at all. And arrogance sees this as is spiritual death, because there's nothing to do as far as trying to find an answer. You see, the real answer is to drop the question. Because the question that we're holding is, how do we establish our equality with God? This is the question we have. How do we do this? And the answer is, we don't. It's impossible. Our equality with God is established by God, not by us. So when you see everything flat, there's nothing to discover. There's no answer to find. You realize there's no way to find any answer at all. Everything's exactly the same. All symbols, time, space, process, and form, concepts, words, measurements, everything. Everything is flat and exactly the same. There's no depth to any of it, so there's no way to, there's no path, there's no path, there's no path anymore. Okay. So for arrogance, it feels this is spiritual death. Why? Because arrogance feels if it doesn't win this contest with God and establish its own value as equal to God, that it will be annihilated. That the price of losing this contest, imaginary contest, is annihilation. So when arrogance sees no possibility to pursue its agenda, it feels that means it's lost, it's annihilation. And I can tell you for sure this is not true at all. There's no annihilation happened. I was still completely present. I felt completely present. I didn't feel the slightest loss of awareness or anything. It's just everything around me just flattened out. I just shrugged my shoulders and said, wow, that's great. It didn't touch me. I was untouched by this flattening. Completely untouched by it. Nothing happened to me. So arrogance has been telling us nothing but lies the entire time. Nothing but lies. A liar from the very beginning. But the logic of arrogance reaches these conclusions. So we look at these conclusions and we say, well, that's logical. Yes, but it's the logic of arrogance. Okay, the premise is wrong. If you accept the premise, then you will reach these false conclusions for sure. But the premise is wrong. So, it's arrogance that's trying to move us towards spiritual death, actually. Because it thinks that in that condition, we won't realize that arrogance is just lying to us, because we won't be able to determine this, you see. Which is why it goes, we cannot die, but we can simulate total mental confusion. We can do that, okay? We are capable, our mind is capable of simulating total mental chaos, and I've experienced this. And you know, this is as bad as it gets. That's as bad as we can possibly ever get. The worst suffering we can possibly ever suffer is simulating total mental chaos, and I've experienced that. And I can tell you it is the worst suffering. There's no question about it. And this is the advice of arrogance. That's its final card that it plays and says, this is the answer. And from in this condition, arrogance can always say, well, there is an answer, but you're so confused, you can't. There's no way you can find it. But the truth is, there is no answer to the question, how do we establish our equality with God? Because we are already equal with God, and we didn't establish that. God did, and we can never change that. So we can't establish our equality with God. God's already done that. So there is no answer to the question, how do we do this? We do it. What we do is we drop the question. And in dropping the question, there's no demand for any answer, you see. So it's all about dropping the question. Not about answering the question, but dropping the question. So again, for those who have been viewing these videos consistently, there was this recognition. There was this... It was just a gentle, I'm not in any sort of enlightened condition at this right now, but this was like in my mind, I said, how about this? It was kind of like, what do I do? I'm trapped. I'm doomed. This is terrible. And then I said, Holy Spirit, what do I do? What do I do? And then there was a feeling like, well, how about this? And everything just flattened out. The whole house flattened. It wasn't crushed. It was very orderly, neat. Somehow just all flattened out in a very nice, beautiful pattern with all the walls neatly on the ground. Everything was flat. And then I just thought, hey, you know, this flatness can extend. What if this flatness extended everywhere? And yet I wasn't flat. I wasn't flat. I had not been flattened out. I was like this kind of... an egg-like shape, an orb-like shape, sort of a roundish ball sort of shape of a presence and awareness and being. It wasn't like I had this sharply delineated body. I was more like an egg, sort of like an egg shape, something like that, sort of like an egg shape. Full mind, full intelligence, full presence, full awareness. Nothing had changed at all in me. As far as consciousness goes, okay, so, but everything was flat. I looked out. You could see a flat city. You know, everything's flat. Just flatland, complete flatland. Now, if you've been watching these videos, I had one video where I talked about, I had this dream where I climbed up on this sort of a flat area. And when I got up on this flat area, started walking around, I realized it was impossible to fall. I couldn't fall. It was completely impossible. I said, just my gosh, this is amazing. This is great. And this was a precursor to where we are now, is in flatland, how can you fall? How can you trip? How can you... There's no pits. There's no... Nothing to trip on. Nothing to get in your way. Nothing to block you. No obscuration. Everything's totally flat. Zero-ness. You know, zero depth to it. Cannot fall. So we're coasting a little bit here, for just a little bit, a little coast. Oh, it suddenly cleared up. My gosh, the sky is all suddenly blue. It was very foggy. The fog came in last night, the cloud cover came in by 7:30 or 8 o'clock, and it was intensely dark and heavy. Wow. And it was, and this morning it was extremely heavy cloud cover and cool and cold and chilly and damp. And suddenly I'm looking up, it's all gone. That's quite extraordinary. That just suddenly disappeared. all the clouds just suddenly disappeared. The sky is completely blue. Wow. That was quite quick. Dramatic. Still chilly, though. Yeah, still very chilly. Chilly Memorial Day here in California. So we're just coasting a little bit, right? Accelerate coast, accelerate coast, accelerate coast, accelerate coast. This is how we go really fast and avoid tyranny, okay? It's either liberation or tyranny for everyone on this planet. It's either liberation or tyranny for everyone on this planet. The age of consideration is over. Church age is over. It's either liberation or tyranny right now for everyone here. And how do we reach liberation? Well, I can tell you that this vision of this flatness, I realized, wow, you know, this is it. This is it. This is the vision of sameness. This is an essential recognition. All thoughts, all thinking, all imagining, all wishing, all conceptualization, all time, space, process, and form, the whole dream, the whole entire dream just flattened out. It's all flat, completely flat. No depth to it at all. Zero. It's the end of arrogance, because everything that arrogance advises is ridiculous, because everything's completely flat. You can't dig into anything. You can't raise anything up or lower anything down. There's no winning. It's possible. There's no winning. It's possible. There's no path that is possible. Everything's just the same flatness. So it's the end of arrogance. It's the end of arrogance. It's the end. There's no way to pursue establishing our equality with God. When you see this complete flatness, there's no way to pursue it. There's no way to pursue it. So it's the end of it. It's the end of the search. You can't search. How can you search in total flatness? Everything's the same flatness. How can you search for anything? You can't search for it, really. So how do we get there again? You know, we can get there. We can get there, and we have to go quickly. But again, it's managing our success as we go fast. That's all important. Managing it, which is we accelerate and we coast, accelerate, coast, accelerate, a coast. Accelerate, full stop on the wow. Accelerate, full stop on the wow. Accelerate, full stop on the wow. This is how we do it. It is doable. It is absolutely doable. The fear has been evaporated for me, you know, to a very significant extent. Not entirely, but to such a significant extent that I could see this and it didn't bother me at all. In fact, I welcomed it. I said, great. Let's keep it that way. Let's keep it all perfectly flat, right? So where is the light we're pursuing? It's flat. Where is the darkness we're pursuing? It's flat. Light as concept is flat. Darkness as concept, is flat. Everything's equally flat. The good and the bad and the ugly, conceptually, is all flat. Equally flat. And yet, I'm untouched by the flatness. And I am not flat. So how do we get there? Practice, practice, practice. Right practice, 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 practice. The church age is over. The age of consideration is over. Now we're in the age of practice. Okay, this is something that has to be really, you have to get this. Otherwise, if you don't practice, the alternative is tyranny. It's plain and simple. Plain and simple. Now, a lot of people here on the planet realize this, but they don't know how to practice. And so what's happening is they're becoming very angry now, because they realize that they're going into tyranny, and they're super very, very upset about this and angry about it. And they expect Jesus to come back and stop this tyranny. That's not what Jesus is about. Jesus is about liberating us from arrogance. And in order to do that, you have to practice. First, there's the age of consideration, which we have gone through, and now it's the time of practice, which doesn't last long, because practice, you can do it very fast, actually. If you do right practice, it goes very quickly for you. And not too quickly. You say, oh, that's not so difficult. Yeah, that wasn't so bad. Wow, that's pretty easy, actually. So we're in the age of practice right now. And this cannot be repeated often enough, and I insist upon it. We're in the age of practice. This is absolutely the basic premise that we're going forward with, is we are now in this new dispensation. It's the age of practice. We have to practice. The alternative practice is tyranny. There's no in-between. There's no in-between. There is no in-between now. Consideration only takes us so far. It only takes us so far. Ultimately, we have to experience this flatness. Okay? We have to experience it. We have to accept it. Ultimately, without fear, without trepidation. And this is so profound that just the consideration of it produces this tremendous wow feeling, okay? So at this point, you have to go into practicing dissipating this wow. You have to do it. And consideration doesn't do it fast enough. It lacks the velocity you need, and you lose your motivation. And if we continue on with, well, what happens is tyranny arises, and this is what's happened in the world. So there's no way back now. You can't go back to the age of consideration, because the age of tyranny is here. And so it's either tyranny or liberation. For us, it's the age of practice. For those who don't practice, it's the age of tyranny, plain and simple. And don't ask me to try and combine the two. Don't ask me to try to bring us back to an age of consideration. That's not going to happen. Nobody can do that here. It's finished. The age of tyranny has taken over that territory entirely and consolidated its position here. It's already happened. We were told in prophecy that for instance, this would be the last pope. This pope is the last pope, and it's true, because the church age has ended. How can there be the final pope when the church age ends? And the church age has already ended. It's finished. So the age of consideration, which is what the papacy represents in this world, is this several thousand years of considering the challenge that Jesus gave us. Jesus gave us this challenge. He says, I want you to start considering whether or not you're equal with God. I want you to start considering that maybe you're equal with God, but that you didn't establish this equality. Okay, I want you to start considering that. So this was the challenge of the church age. We considered this. We said, maybe. We said, maybe. Okay, so Jesus said, I want you to start with maybe. You have to start somewhere. See, Jesus came to those who hadn't even gotten started. There are many of us on this planet who are sunk in extreme arrogance. And we're pursuing arrogance to such an extent we were just in constant tribal warfare and sacrificial. The facts are that in ancient times there was a lot of human sacrifice take place. People sacrificed babies to a very large extent. Children, babies were sacrificed to God, supposedly to God, the God of arrogance, actually, which isn't a God at all. It's our own logic of arrogance. And from that, they went to sacrificing cows and sheep and pigeons and, you know, various goats, whatever they sacrificed. A very heavy sacrifice going on, and very intense warfare and conquest, constant conquest. We were in a time of virtually constant constant conquest. So we were sunk in this desperate belief of arrogance that if we don't win, if we don't establish our own equality with God, we're going to be annihilated. We will have nothing, no equality, zero. So we were caught up in this extremely fearful struggle of we have to win. So we were following the advice of arrogance to a very extreme degree. Jesus had to come into this situation and get us started back on the path to liberation, salvation, enlightenment. And that was a very difficult ministry, mission, very difficult. Because, you know, once begun is half done. Getting started is the difficult part. So Jesus was able to get those who were deeply sunk in arrogance, get them started. A lot of them get started. But once you get started, ultimately the goal is you have to finish. If you don't finish, then you fail. You failed in your consideration. So we're in a situation now where we have to finish this. So Jesus is back saying, okay, it's finish time. Yeah, it's time now to finish. This is a new dispensation. How do you finish? Well, you can't just keep spinning your wheels with consideration. You cannot do that. I tried. It doesn't work. I've been intensely involved with this for my whole life, but 38 years, you might say, all-out emergency mode. And I found out that no matter how much you consider the truth, if you don't practice, which is a more intense way, speed things up, you're not going to succeed. You will not succeed. You don't have enough speed and momentum to dissipate the fear, the continuity fear. We have a very severe continuity fear. We're so used to listening to the voice of arrogance, we feel if we don't listen to the voice of arrogance, we'll be destroyed. That's part of it. And also, if we don't listen to it, we're afraid we'll be catapulted into, you know, extreme bliss that we won't know how to function. We'll be freaked out by it, okay? So we have this sort of, this continuity fear, which is part, you know, fear of extreme happiness. And the other is a fear of annihilation, sort of. We have this complex of fear. And so we're very frightened about this. This causes a great, great blockage. It blocks us. And we can spend time considering, talking, dialoguing, you know, that can go on forever. But what happens is it doesn't work. Ultimately, it doesn't finish the job for us. And so we start losing interest, losing momentum, and we start sinking down. And before long, we've lost our will. And what do? We desperately try to make a deal with arrogance and try to combine arrogance and truth. Lies and truth. And when we try to do that, when we slide into tyranny. That's when we slide into it, become very vulnerable to tyranny. That's exactly what's happened on this planet. It's exactly what's happened. So many who had been engaged in this consideration, this challenge that Jesus gave us, this challenge, they've lost their momentum. They've lost their will. And because of that, so many have lost their will. The Pope, in order to keep the institution of the church going, is basically saying, hey, everybody, it's time to make a compromise between truth and lies. And that's the answer. In order to keep people going to church. Okay? Because so many who took up this challenge, we call it, those who took up the challenge of Jesus, we call them Christians. This is taking up the challenge. Challenging yourself. It's all important. If you don't challenge yourself, if you don't challenge arrogance, you will remain in arrogance and continue to follow its advice and find yourself in very, very wicked, vicious, vulnerable, attacking, chaotic situations and distorted, perverted, horrible situations, trying to enmesh yourself in the body, trying to fixate yourself as a body, lost in all this depth. Like an abyss here, a cliff here, an abyss here. All this depth, you're thinking symbols and concepts seem to have all this great significance and depth to you, as if a dream had some real depth to it, you know, instead of just being flat. A dream is just a dream. It's flat as far as the level of dream. As far as level of truth, dream is just flat. It's all a dream. There's no depth to it. There's not part of it true and part of it a dream. It's all one flat dream. But you won't see that when you follow the vice of arrogance. You think the dream has all this depth to it, okay? And this is the trouble. So those who take up the challenge, we can call them Christians. We can call them Christians. You don't have to call yourself a Christian at all. But if you have taken up the challenge to consider that you are equal with God, but you didn't establish equality. God did, to consider it. Maybe. Then you've taken up the challenge that Jesus came to this world and gave us this challenge. Now, if you don't get to finishing this consideration, finishing it, then you're going to lose momentum and you're going to finally get tired and you say, wow, I don't know what to do. I've tried so much. I've tried so hard. God, I've prayed so much. I've prayed. Help me, God, help me. I pray. And still I feel like I'm just spinning my wheels. I'm tired. You know, and then you start deciding, I need to make a compromise. I need to make a compromise between arrogance and the spirit of truth, because I can't finish. So I what else can I do? I want to retain the good parts, you know, goodness of truth, but I can't realize it. So I have to also deal with arrogance. So I need to make a compromise between arrogance and truth. And when you do that, you actually are slide into tyranny, and your mindset actually becomes one of tyrannical. And you end up supporting tyranny. And this is how so many in the world now are supporting tyranny, actually supporting it. Those what you call lapsed Christians are very much supporting tyranny. Those who've just basically said, wow, I just can't make it. I just can't do it. I'm stalled out. So there is this big stall out taking place. Now, what the leaders of Christianity have done is that they're desperate to keep the money pouring in and the institutions going. I mean, in order to keep the institutions going, you have to keep the money pouring in. Okay, I mean, that's not a criticism. It's just a fact. And in order to do that, you have to keep the membership has to be strong. You can't let it dwindled into nothing. You have to keep new people coming in constantly. You have to keep people interested. So how do you keep the attention of all those who have lapsed, who are saying, wow, I just can't finish. I don't feel like I have the juice to do it. You end up teaching compromise. In order to keep people in church, because that's where most people are at now. Okay, most lapsed Christians are in a state of are entertaining compromise between arrogance and truth, between lies and truth, between arrogance and the Holy Spirit. They're entertaining a compromise, and in order to keep these people's attention, the church has to also stand for accept compromise and say, yeah, compromise is the way to go. That's the way to go. And the Pope has, from his words since the day he became Pope Francis, he has been teaching compromise and saying to all Catholics around the world, don't worry, folks. The church is going to continue strong into this new millennium. And we're going to have the message you want to hear. So keep coming to church, keep supporting the church, because we'll teach you the message you want to hear. And this is the message you want to hear, right? And it's this compromise message, right? And people are saying, yeah, oh, that's good. I mean, you get all these lapsed Christians, many of them that call themselves liberals now, progressives, and they're the ones who are cheering this Pope, saying, wow, that's the message we've been waiting to hear. And they're even considering, maybe I want to go back to the church, actually. If the church can accept what I want to hear, if the church is telling me what I want to hear, then I think I want to go back, because I kind of miss it. You know, lapsed Christians miss the church, and they miss all of that. Absolutely. How can you not miss it? So they want it. It's just they want it to give the message of compromise, which they have lapsed into now. And so when the church is teaching compromise, it's actually teaching tyranny. It's actually it's a supporting tyranny. And these church leaders then end up being on the same page as these, you know, political tyrants who are trying to become dictators over us, actually. And they end up supporting one another and say, yeah, this is good. And we end up supporting tyranny and put ourselves under tyranny is what happens. So this is the last pope. It's finished. Church age has come to an end. We were told the church age would have a certain dispensational time period, and then it would come to an end. It has now come to an end. Churches around the world are now teaching compromise. I'm speaking for Christianity, and maybe someone else will speak for the other religions, but for right now, I will speak of Christianity, okay? To start out with, it's because this is something that's very blatantly obvious, and because there's so many Christians in the world, it's very important to talk about this. So what do you do? What do you do if you're lapsed? If you think you've given up, like, oh, I failed Jesus' challenge. I can't figure out how to succeed. I can't figure out how to succeed. You can succeed. You can succeed. I've been succeeding at this. Okay. You have to practice. Now, during the church age, did any practice take place? Yes, some did. Some did. There were some who were very advanced and got to the point of practicing right practice. Not a lot. Not a lot. There were a few saints. There's some that did finish. Some say that St. Patrick, for example, is someone who's finished. St. Francis is someone who finished. St. Teresa is someone who finished. There's various saints throughout Christianity who people say that they finished. Well, you know, some of them may very well have finished, actually. Okay. But they're not a lot, because it's the age of consideration. And so the right spiritual practice wasn't really engaged in to a very large extent at all. It was mostly prayer and petitioning God. That's not right spiritual practice. Petitioning God is not right spiritual practice, because you're really petitioning arrogance. The way to right spiritual practice is through assertion. You assert the truth. You assert the truth. Okay. I am equal with God, but I didn't establish that equality. I know that I'm already equal with God, but I did not establish that equality. God did. Okay, this is called making an assertion. This is right spiritual practice. This is what works. This is what works. But very few have actually tried this throughout history. But this is what we do here. In the Christian tradition, very few have done that. There have been contemplation, which is great, you know, is intense consideration, okay, which is good. As far as the age of consideration, contemplation is very good. There's been meditation, there's been contemplation, there's been prayer. All that is part of the church age of consideration. But to finish this consideration, you need to make assertions. So this is the age of assertion right now, making spiritual assertions. It's the age of practice, right? Spiritual practice. And you do that through making assertions. And this is what I have been shown and trained in, and it's working for me. It is working for me. When you're able to see this flatness and just say, oh yeah, this is great, this is what I really want, this is the answer I've been looking for, wonderful, then you know it's working for you, because you've dissipated tremendous amount of continuity fear. Tremendous amount of continuity fear has been dissipated. It dissipated quite quickly. So I tried to finish up the age of consideration through intense consideration, okay? And it didn't ultimately work. It didn't work. And so I had no choice. I said, either I'm going to slide into tyranny and dress tyranny up in fancy dress and say it's beautiful, or I'm going to have to practice, one of the two. So first I went through a phase of compromise, where I just tried to dress up the compromise real beautifully, okay? Didn't work. It was a disaster for me. And then I got back to more deep consideration, and still it didn't finish things up. And then I realized I can't go back to compromise. I know how that works. I know it's a disaster. No matter how beautifully you dress compromise up, it doesn't work. It still will pull you right into tyranny and wickedness, for sure. For sure. So I said, I can't go back to that. It doesn't work. So what do I do? I asked the Holy Spirit, okay, what do I do, Holy Spirit? I don't know what to do. And then the Holy Spirit said, there's this practice. You can practice. Start making assertions. Start asserting this. You got affirmation, assertion. We're talking about the exact same thing, okay? But affirming, I like assertion. It's a little more punch to it. You know, I say, I am You know, I am free. I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. So what the Holy Spirit did is it pointed out to me that Jesus has been suggesting this, you know, in his new dispensation, and in A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, the other voice, some of the material he's made available for us to help us with finishing our consideration, going from maybe to yes, okay. I realized that, oh yeah, he's saying this. Just say this. He says, just if you want something to really say, this is the most effective. What this is the most effective practice you can do is just assert, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. So I started asserting that, you know, all the time, as much as possible. I started working with this. Now I'd already been working with assertions for a year or two. Getting into it. But what I did was I accelerated it. And now I'm able to really, you know, work very strongly with assertions. And it has been evaporating the continuity fear, as the Holy Spirit said it would, as Jesus said it would. So when I see this flattening happen, this flatness, I suddenly, oh, I say, good. Great. That means the practice is working. Practice is working. And I say, wow, this is great. And full stop in the wow. So I continue my practice. All right. This is how it goes. You don't freak out when you see, oh my gosh, it's working. I start freaking out. You say, wow. And when you say, wow, what do you say? Oh, full stop in the wow. Let me coast for a little while now. So it stays smooth. This practice helps smooth out your, it smooths out your success. It smooths it out. Whereas before, without this practicing, the success, it would be success, backlash. And after a while, you say, wow, I just can't take this anymore. I just got to find a compromise between arrogance and the Holy Spirit, because I just can't, I'm on a teeter-totter here, going back and forth. You know, this is, and it's too stressful. This is terrible for me. So you have to smooth out your success. Smooth it out, because your success is extreme, actually. So you have to smooth it out, and that's what we do here. This is what the practice is all about. So I hope that those lapsed Christians can realize there is a way, and that Jesus is actually, he's already back, he's already returned. I believe he returned just towards the beginning of May of 2015. I can go back and view my videos. It's not a big deal for me exact to pin it down. See, it's not important. That's towards the end of April and the beginning of May, Jesus at least made known to me, and he actually made known to the world, I was just had the ears to hear it, that he's back. He's back. And so he's bringing this push to practice now. He's bringing this push, this new challenge to practice. And you can do it. You can do it. Absolutely, you can do it. It's not as difficult as we think, but in the motivation we have, well, if we don't do it, we're going to slide into tyranny for sure here, for sure. Because consideration has been termited, been sabotaged by arrogance here, very severely. The church has been sabotaged. All this has been severely sabotaged. So the church cannot regain the type of authority it had in the age of consideration anymore. It's not possible. There's been so many scandals, so much sabotage taking place in so many ways. The only way the church can maintain its institutional presence here is to teach a mixed message, okay, or to shift into the age of practice. It's the only way. But of course, in doing that, it will, you know, it won't maintain its membership numbers, because many people most likely will not practice. They will say, ah, that's too difficult for me, you know. So the church is now teaching a mixed message, very much a mixed message, and the people that follow that will be very vulnerable, will be inherently vulnerable to the advice of arrogance, which leads you to tyranny, leads you into a terrible situation. It doesn't work. Leads you into a dead end, very dead end. Leads you into death. Part of this imagined contest we have with God is we believe we establish a covenant with God, which is really an agreement to for the rules of the contest. Okay, we think that we're having a contest, and by the way, there is no contest. We've never induced God into any contest whatsoever. Okay, but we believe we have, and part of this, the rules of the contest, is, as we say, called the covenant with God, and part of that covenant is death for bodies, death for bodies, death for everything. This is, we're projecting everything that's taking place in this world, bodies and world nature. That's a mental projection. But we have this, believe we have a covenant with God, the rules of this contest, where we have to project death. Okay, we have to project death. So the wages of continuing on with arrogance is death, plain and simple. Believing that you're dying, you're going to die, and believe that you've gone through death, and that believing that everything is dying, okay, instead of being completely flat. How can complete flatness die? You see, so when I saw everything flat, arrogance says, well, everything's died. You just, it must completely destroy you. You know, everything's dead. Now, how can flatness die? It was never alive in the first place. It was always just completely flat. So, that's the end of this false notion of death. That's the end of this covenant. Death is just an imaginary covenant we have with God, thinking that there's some depth to the dream, that there's a contest taking place, a meaningful contest. There's no meaningful contest taking place in symbols at all. No meaningful contest taking place whatsoever. Symbols have not induced God into any sort of contest with spirit at all. It's impossible to induce God into a contest. So we're in the age of what? Practice. Okay, now, sooner or later, this will sink into you, and you'll get it. It's just a matter of feeling, do I have the support for this? Am I going to be able to do it? Do I have the support for it? You know, it's a question of that. You're mulling it over, you know, in your mind. It's like, wow, can I really succeed at this, or is it just going to be more failure? And so you're waiting to see success. You're waiting to see, you know, you're waiting for, say, well, I think I can do it, and I'm going to try, but you know, so there's a little bit of hanging back taking place in most everyone right now. But you really need to decide, hey, it's kind of like a diet. You decide, you know, I got to start it. That's it. No more joking around. Everybody reaches that point. You step on a scale and you look at it and say, oh my God, this is horrible. I got to start my diet today. Because if I don't, I'm going to end up, you know, as just a miserable fat blob. I've got to start my diet today. Everybody reaches that point, or most of us do. Some don't. They say, no, I can't do it. I have no will. It's impossible. And they keep listening to arrogance that tells them that has a solution to them. Remember, the solution of arrogance is what? Total mental chaos is the final solution for that arrogance will give you. And you will find that you don't want to abide in that. You'll say, ah, I know for a fact, this is not what I really want. As a momentary experience, sure, it's kind of very interesting. But as far as abiding in it permanently, no way. Because arrogance will tell you the answer, your answer that it has for you is permanent abidance and total mental chaos. That's its final bit of advice that says this is the answer that you've been seeking. Total, permanent abidance and total mental chaos. And when I reached that, and I found out that's what arrogance was insisting upon as its final step. Beyond that, there is no advice it has as the final advice. I realized, wow, this is insane. This is completely ridiculous. Permanent abidance in this total mental chaos. I said, no way. That's the end of listening to arrogance. You know, that's it. No way. As a momentary experience, quite amazing, extremely terrifying, madness, total madness. It felt as if I was going to be completely insane, madly insane, with totally chaotic mind forever. There's no way to get out of it. This is what I felt. No way to get out of it. Permanent. And it's like, wow, I don't want this. And then I was out of it. Just like that. So it only lasted for an instant, actually. It only lasted for an instant. But it was an instant that felt like it was going to be forever. See, this is the trauma of it. It's very traumatic. You can't have any worse trauma than that, actually. But it just lasted for an instant. And then I said, oh, help. I need another advisor. This advisor is completely insane. Arrogance is totally insane. And then I became aware there was another advisor. So I felt like, oh, I'm being heard by something. Something is hearing me. I was aware of that. It was like a subtle presence that was aware and hearing me and accepting my call for help and saying, yeah, I'm here to help. And ultimately, we call this the grace of God, the Holy Spirit. Voice of reason, Spirit of truth was there for me. And it said, don't worry. I'll get you free of this forever. Don't worry. Together, we'll walk together to freedom. This is what I felt. We will walk together to absolute liberation from this. And you'll never have to worry about it again. But we have to walk together, and it's going to take a little while. And you need to start considering practicing. Start considering, that you need to practice. So I tried to go beyond consideration to practice. And, it's a gradual, slow kind of build up towards this, but eventually I've got here, so I did it. So when you get to this vision of flatness, you know you've been practicing in a very effective way. And when you're not bothered by it, you know you've been doing very good practice. When you can embrace it and say, oh, great, I'm not troubled by this. This is what I really want. You know you've been doing very effective practice. So this practice of speeding up, slowing down, accelerating, coasting, acceleration, coasting, acceleration, coasting. This is very, very effective. Full stop in the wow. Walking together in the wow is what we're doing here. We're walking together in the wow. Where we accelerate, then we coast, accelerate and coast, accelerate and coast. And this will get it done for you. As long as, if you, those who do this are going to find their continuity fear is rapidly evaporates. You're not bothered by the truth anymore. In fact, you welcome it. And so we have these little coasting periods where we just, okay, let's just coast now. Where we literally calm down. Now, if you're on some stimulant, how can you calm down? You can't. See, the whole practice is about this accelerating and coasting. If you're on drugs, how can you get off of those drugs? You can't. The influence of the drug is still with you. So you can't get free of that. So it doesn't work. Drugs do not work. Arrogance is actually advising this world to get on drugs. It's advising everybody to get on drugs right now. That's part of its grand strategy. And everybody says, oh, really, really, that's great. We can get on drugs and, oh, okay. Drugs don't work. I've never, ever come across anyone or heard of anyone who ever reached true liberation through drugs. Never. A lot of people tried. No one's ever done it. No one ever will. What happens is you get into some very clever compromise. You dress up arrogance in very fancifully. That has happened. That's happened a lot, actually. Indeed it has. You get these characters who think they found some super awesome way to dress up arrogance. and in their all their drug taking, and you know, all their sex, drugs, and rock and roll, they think they're very clever. And they found a real clever way to dress up arrogance. It says, hey, this works. Arrogance is so beautiful. You know, come on, everybody. Let's celebrate how beautiful arrogance is. You know, but they're not enlightened. It doesn't work. They're not liberated. And they're not really teaching liberation. They're just teaching a side trip. They're just wasting your time, ultimately. There are some very severe time wasters, and here's some very clever tricksters here in this world that slowed me down. You know, I think it slowed everybody down over the last, let's say, 60 years. There were some very clever tricksters who had thought they had dressed arrogance up in a very clever ways, and they want everybody to celebrate, acknowledge how clever they were. And they say, hey, look at this. You can have your cake and eat it too. You can have lies and truth at the same time. You don't have to. You can have this compromise. You don't have to finish and ultimately drop and see the absolute flatness of it all. No, you can have it all. You can have both. And we've dressed arrogance up in this wonderful, really cool spiritual way, you know. And let's celebrate that. And so, you know, some got hooked into that. A lot of lapsed Christians got hooked into that, and they said, wow, maybe this is the answer. And by Christian, I also mean Judeo-Christian, because Christianity did have its roots in Judaism, or Judaism, however you want to pronounce it. Judaism or Judaism, tomato or tomato, potato or potato. And so some Jews went with, accepted the challenge, some didn't. Some rejected Jesus, rejected the challenge, and said, no, we're going to continue on with trying to perfect the law, okay? Trying to perfect the advice of arrogance. Trying to perfect the advice of arrogance. Trying to follow the advice of arrogance perfectly. Okay, the Old Testament, the law, is all about trying to follow the advice of arrogance perfectly, as if that's somehow going to make the advice effective. Okay, this is upside down, backwards, magical thinking. So, quite a few Jews took up the challenge of Jesus, that Jesus gave them, because they had already tried to perfect the law perfectly. See, the Jews have been trying to perfect the arrogance, trying to perfect arrogance, trying to follow arrogance perfectly for a long time, trying to follow the advice of arrogance perfectly. They thought this is going to work. So they put a lot of effort into it. I mean, how long? You know, 1,500 years? I mean, a lot of effort. And some of them realized, wow, you know, we've been doing this for a long time. It doesn't work. What the heck do we do? It doesn't work. We've been following all these laws and rituals and, you know, extreme amount of laws, do's and don'ts, trying to follow to the letter exactly what arrogance has been telling us. Arrogance tells us to do this. We're going to do this perfectly, and we're going to do it perfectly for a long time. And they said, well, gosh, we've already done that, and it doesn't work. So Jesus came to the Jews and said, hey, because there were some there who said, help, help, help. It doesn't work. It doesn't work. And so Jesus said, okay, I'm bringing you this challenge. Consider Spirit of Truth, what the Spirit of Truth has to say. Consider that indeed you are already equal with God, but you did not establish your equality. God did. You're already equal. So there's nothing you need to do at all to be equal. You don't need all these laws. Jesus said, came to free us from the law. New Testament, free us from the law, the challenge. And so the original Christians were almost all Jewish, okay? And then it gradually spread to Gentiles. But the leaders of the church were Jewish. And they're the ones who said, took up the challenge, okay? So we call it Judeo-Christian tradition, because indeed Christianity came out of the history of the Jews of having tried to follow the advice of arrogance perfectly, as if that would make the advice effective. This is wishful, hopeful thinking. This is the advice of arrogance. Arrogance says, oh, you know, you'll succeed at establishing equality with God on your own, you being establishing it, but you have to follow my advice perfectly, you see. And so the Jews said, okay, we'll do this. We'll try this. So they tried. They tried, and they did a great job trying. You know, they really did. Very dedicated and determined. And very strict, very, very strict about it. If you didn't follow the laws exactly, you know, it's death. You had to follow these laws. And of course, they tried to kill Jesus because Jesus broke, you know, healed on the Sabbath. He said, you know, said to this man, crippled man, pick up your bed and walk. Pick up your bed and walk. You're fine. You're healed. Go. And they said, hey, the Pharisees. And said, hey. And the Sadducees says, they can't carry your bed on the Sabbath. You can't do that. That's one of our laws. We have to follow the laws. Otherwise, we'll be annihilated. See, if we don't follow the laws that that the vice that arrogance gave us, we will be annihilated. So you're breaking the law. And if we allow you to break the law without punishing you, we're going to be annihilated. So we have to punish you. We have to kill you. So they're very strict. So, but there were some Jews were calling out for help, saying, "Help! This is we can't take this anymore. You know, this is just too much. It's just too much, and we don't see any light at the end of the tunnel. We've been working on this for so long, and we're just stuck in all these restrictions and laws, and we must do it this way." And our lives are just so paralyzed by this, you know. We're so paralyzed and we're so frightened still. And we're so oppressed still. We haven't been liberated, you know. The Romans we've been oppressed by the, you know, Herod and then now the Romans. And throughout history, the Babylonian captivity by the Egyptians, you know. Just our history has been, you know, it hasn't worked for us. And so what do we do? What do we do? We don't know what to do. Help us, God. Help us, help us, help us. Ah, here came Jesus. He said, okay, here's the challenge, folks. Here is the challenge. Now, one of the greatest, you know, early Christians was St. Paul. Now, St. Paul, now I don't think any of the apostles or evangelists were completely free of arrogance. Completely free. They hadn't completely, you know, so they still had some habits of arrogance with them. Okay, they still had that. Jesus acknowledged that. He said, you know, you don't quite understand what I'm telling you. But St. Paul said a lot of really good things, actually. Had a lot of spiritual awareness. And a lot of his teachings were very, very accurate, actually. Not necessarily all of them. Of course, he thought that everybody would raise from the dead, the graves, and the resurrection would happen in his lifetime, and all this kind of, that was still Pharisee teaching, which he was a Pharisee, Paul, a Jew. But he had a tremendous turnaround experience. He was persecuting Christians. He was demanding their death. He was responsible for the stoning of Saint Stephen. And he hated Christians because they were breaking all these laws, these restrictions, Jewish law restrictions. They weren't obeying the law, you know, the religious law, and they were an anathema. And he felt they were going to be responsible for the Jewish nation being destroyed, being as like the Babylonian captivity had happened, and the Egyptian before Babylonian captivity. And lots of different, you know, Syrians coming in and attacking them. And now the Romans were controlling Judea. And so they blamed all misfortune, the Jews blamed all misfortune upon them not following the law perfectly. You see, if they didn't follow the law perfectly, they felt they'd be annihilated. And so when the enemies came in and destroyed their cities, and, you know, they said, that's because we didn't follow the law perfectly. It's our fault we didn't follow the law perfectly. So when they see these Christians, these Jews, not following the law perfectly, the early Christians were Jews. Saint Paul, who was Saul of Tarsus at that time, said, "Hey, you know, you guys are going to bring destruction upon us." And so he started persecuting. He was a chief prosecutor in Jerusalem of Christians. He's a very able person, very determined, very zealous, full of zeal. Paul was full of zeal. He was like a world beater type, you know. He was just really, he was determined to get results. So he was heading up all this sort of inquisitional prosecution of Christians from Jerusalem, and was pushing for the death penalty for all these Christians. Stoning to death, really. And he was on the road to Damascus to prosecute some cases in Damascus of Christians, where he suddenly had this experience where he said Jesus appeared to him. And the light of truth struck him so strongly that he was blind, he couldn't even see for 3 days. And he flipped the script. He completely flipped the script, basically. You know, the basic script was flipped for him. And he suddenly realized, wow, the law doesn't work. The law does not work. Grace works. We are saved by not by the law, but through grace. And somehow, St. Paul, this set into him very strongly. And so he became very determined to speak the truth in the world, and suffered for doing this greatly. Beaten, harassed, attacked, imprisoned. I mean, he went through all sorts of great, very severe difficulties, because he was absolutely determined to teach the truth of salvation through grace, that we're already equal with God. In other words, we're already equal with God, but we did not establish our equality. Now, I say that these apostles were not completely free of the habits of arrogance, and so they still needed to say, well, how did we get equal? They're still thinking, how did we get equal? Well, the truth that we know now is we didn't get equal, we were created equal. See, but they still are thinking now. They say, well, Jesus somehow did something to make us equal or reconcile us with God so God would accept us as equal, you know. So it's something that Jesus did. Now, there's nothing that Jesus did. Nothing that Jesus told us, that we were created equal. All spirit was created equal with God, but spirit did not create its own equality. God did. This is the truth. And it's taken us thousands of years to finally recognize this and accept it. So they didn't quite understand that. Paul did not quite get that. But he did get a lot of it. He did get a lot of it. So Pauline Christianity is good for the age of consideration has really been Pauline Christianity, actually, to a very large extent. I don't know if the Eastern Orthodox Church would accept that or not. I'm not entirely sure about that. But it's permeated Christianity. What St. Paul did permeated Christianity, because he is the one that wrote all the letters. He was the one traveling to all the different early churches, which were mostly Jews, right, who are now calling themselves Christians, or at least thinking, I don't know if they call themselves Christians, but they thought on themselves. He took up the challenge. He traveled, he visited, he wrote letters constantly exhorting them, this is the way to do it, this is the way, this is the way, this is the way. And by and large, his advice was very good advice, by and large. I wouldn't call it perfectly good, but by and large, it was very good advice. And that's used to this day. The Acts in the New Testament, generally, like in Catholic Church, they read something from the Old Testament, the first reading. Second reading is from the New Testament, which often is a reading from Acts, especially during Easter season up to Pentecost, which was yesterday. The first reading is from Acts not the synoptic, the Gospels, but the Acts, the letters, the epistles, and all that. And then the second reading can also be, I think, from Acts, or it can be from the synoptic Gospels. And then the third reading that the priest does the homily, but the No, generally the priest does the reading, I think. It's just certainly. From the Gospels, the three synoptic Gospels and the Gospel of John, from the the evangelists, which were Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but the letters were written by various. Paul wrote a lot of letters, and I think there were some. John wrote some. I think there were some others written by other various early Christians writing letters to one another in these areas, these churches that had been established in various cities throughout the area, Asia Minor, we call Turkey, from Jerusalem up through into all the way to Rome, throughout Greece, Macedonia, Thrace, those areas, and Cyprus. There were communities of Christians in all those areas, mostly Jews, okay, mostly Jews, who had converted now to Christianity, to had converted to taking up the challenge that salvation through grace, that's the challenge, not through works, not through the law, but through grace. And ultimately, this means recognizing, accepting that we are equal with God, and we never did anything to earn this equality or to establish it in any way whatsoever. Why? Because we were created equal by God. God established our equality from the very beginning. This is the truth. Jesus didn't do anything to establish our equality. God established it. Okay? And this is the ultimate truth. This is finishing the whole path of consideration, is finishing it. So the Jews took a leadership position in Christianity because they had this long history of intense effort of trying to follow the vice of arrogance perfectly, and they realized it doesn't work. But through making this effort, they were very disciplined. Okay, they had a tremendous amount of discipline, and so they were able to then bring this discipline into helping spread this gospel of salvation through grace, which is really accepting the challenge of that Jesus brought us. They're able to do a great job of that. And ultimately then this spread out to the Gentiles. They called the Gentiles, which we call the pagans, who had not had such a long history of discipline trying to follow the laws perfectly. Everybody had their own, nature, spirits, and this and this and that. But the Jews have been monotheistic for a long time, trying to say, let us just follow, one line of advice perfectly. The pagans were all over the map. They still doing, Sal, very barbaric stuff and indulging in, the flesh, trying to engross themselves in the flesh to a very large extent. The Romans were somewhat disciplined. The Greeks and the Romans have had a lot of philosophy and discipline, but Europe in general was a lot of very severe, crazy stuff going on. Still a lot of human sacrifice going on. Very, very much into a warrior mentality, attack mentality. We're kind of savage, quite savage in a lot of ways. And so, the gospel to them, what? What are you talking about? So it's been a slow process for them to hear this. They insisted on, no, we need to keep dressing arrogance up. You want us to listen to this? Okay, let's put a really pretty dress on it. Let's call it mother worship. They're very much into a lot of mother worship, the great mother of, and that inspired them to victory in battle. And they loved conquest and battle and savagery and did not have a lot of real. Not what you'd call be highly civilized, okay? And so they were heavily enmeshed in believing in arrogance, that if they just follow this arrogance, they're going to be happy. And they weren't, so they didn't have the kind of discipline, and they needed to develop this gradually. So it's been a work in progress to bring this consideration to the world. Bring this consideration to the world. It's been several thousand years, and in a lot of places in the world, they're still going heavily pagan. You know, it's back to the sex, drugs, and rock and roll. You know, these rave festivals and these parades that they have, just, you know, celebrating the flesh. You know, they've fallen back into that. Well, they were that way to an extreme extent before. I mean, the Jews had very strict laws. They've been following very strict laws for a long time. You know, you're circumscribing your diet, your behavior, everything. Purity laws, they called it. Purity laws. So they have been intensely following purity laws. The Vedic culture also had been intensely into that, which is why they were able to get with Buddhism, which was a culture of practice too, consideration and practice. But the Jews have been following these purity laws for a long time, and refined them. Now the pagans, you know, they said anything goes. You know, their advice to a large extent was, hey, you know, anything goes, and praying to any nature spirit, you know, and just the way of, wow, taking so many drugs, and, you know, sex, drugs, and rock and roll for them, and it's still, and pagans, then they backslide, they go right back into that, actually. They go right back into it. The more the merrier. You know, the more the merrier. So they kind of needed, when they got into Christianity, they kind of said, well, maybe. Well, okay, but it's been a time of maybe, so that's okay, maybe, they said. But they still said maybe their old ways are right too. They said, well, maybe this new way is right, salvation through grace, but maybe this old way of just indulgence, let's just indulge the flesh, maybe that's right. Materiality, indulgence of the flesh. See, the Jews have been very severe to the flesh for a long time, whereas the pagans, no, they said, how can we indulge the flesh in new and creative ways? Let's find new ways to indulge the flesh. Hey, maybe that land over there, let's get that, let's find, you know, let's conquer, let's indulge the flesh, let's find out, maybe there's some sensual delights there, some better game, better food, better this, you know, let's party. So when Christianity was brought to the pagans, they said, well, maybe this is it. Maybe we do need to crucify the passions of the flesh. And then they also said, but maybe we don't. You know, maybe we don't. So they insisted on bringing the dress of party dress, you know, in along with Christianity. They said, hey, we need to keep the Great Mother in this that said, hey, indulge. Enjoy yourselves. You're here to enjoy yourselves. Let's party. So they insist that the party goddess be brought in, and so Christianity dressed it up in disguise, you know, But they allowed it in there. So Christianity allowed a lot of paganism in the church because it was a time of maybe-ness. Consider this. So it's okay. It was a considerate. So they said, oh, maybe yes, maybe no. Maybe yes, maybe no. And then Protestantism was sort of a new dispensation, a new phase of this. It was not so much a new dispensation, but a kind of progress and consideration, where they said, "Hey, wait a minute, you know, we're leaning more towards yes than no. Let's cut the party stuff out. Let's say no to that. So I don't think that's it. I don't think indulging the flesh is it." And so they kicked out a lot of the compromise out of their church. They started a new church, so to speak, Protestant churches, Lutherans, Calvinists, that spread to various other Episcopalians and Baptists and Pentecostals and Evangelicals and Presbyterians and Congregationalists, and you know, it goes on and on and on and on. So no more goddess in the Protestant denominations. No more party goddess. You know, who's really saying, hey, it's okay. Yeah, you can do some of this Christian stuff, but the old stuff's okay too. The old pagan stuff, you can keep doing that's okay. It's okay. That kind of thing. No more of that. They tried to get rid of all the trappings of that. And they tried to become more severe, more oriented towards finishing. So I think we can do this. It's grace. Martin Luther basically said, hey, folks, it's by grace. Okay, it's not by works. Because the Catholic Church was selling indulgences. And you know what? The Pope just recently reinstituted indulgences, saying if you attend, like, World Family Day or World, this big gatherings of the Catholic Church, he said, anyone who attends this, or first he said, anyone who attends this is has an indulgence where they have got to spend less time in purgatory. Okay. And it says, well, how, what? It says, yeah, the Pope has the authority as a vicar of Christ on earth here, has the authority to lessen your time in purgatory. So if you attend this big gathering of Catholicism, I think it was like World Family Day or something, or you get less time in purgatory. After you die, they say, well, you spend time in purgatory, then after that, then you get to go to heaven. Less time. And then people say, well, wait a minute, we're poor people. A lot of us are very poor. We can't afford to fly to where it's taking place. I don't know where it's taking place. I can easily check, but we can't afford it. And the Pope said, huh. Wow, that's not fair, is it? Okay, in the spirit of fairness and equality, then the Pope said, if you watch it on the internet, okay, if you use the social media, if you do social media and internet on this, you also get the indulgences. You get the same indulgences. And people are saying, oh, what a great Pope. What a fantastic Pope. What an equalitarian Pope. My gosh, But he's back selling work. He's back selling works, back on the doctrine of works. If you do this works, you get indulgences. This is what caused the split of Christianity into Catholicism and Protestantism, is Reformation, Martin Luther. Martin Luther said, hey, wait a minute. You're saying everybody has to make these pilgrimages to Rome in order to get these indulgences. There's Rome's been selling indulgences that you get much less time in purgatory. If you go to Rome, well, going to Rome, you have to actually pay this money when you get there. They were selling indulgences. They had all these people going about, all these religious orders were engaged in selling indulgences to people, saying you're going to go to hell, you're going to burn in hell terribly, or you're going to burn in purgatory, you're going to have a terrible time. But if you buy this indulgence, we're authorized salesmen from the Pope telling us, if you give us money for this indulgence, guess what? You get to bypass that. You get 100 years less in purgatory or whatever, And so all these people say, oh my gosh, yeah, I got it. So the church generated massive income through selling these indulgences. And Martin Luther says, wait, 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 wait. That's not the gospel. That's not what the challenge that Jesus gave us. The challenge that Jesus gave us, consider that your salvation is through grace. Ultimately meaning God created us equal to God. We didn't establish our own equality, but we are equal without doing anything, without earning it in one bit. We don't need to do there's nothing that we need to do ever to earn our equality with God, because God created us equal, and we can never change that. It's impossible to change it. We will always be equal with God, no matter what. This is the essential message of salvation through grace. And so this caused this terrible split and terrible wars, religious wars in Europe. Because the Catholics didn't want to lose all their income. They're getting all their income from selling indulgences. And of course, you can't sell them to Protestants. They say that's bogus. It's bogus. That's nonsense. So it was really an economic war. So now the Pope is back selling indulgences, essentially, right? In other words, pour all this money into the church, attend, buy, he's getting back to indulgences, actually. Not that they ever left that entirely, but it's becoming very blatant now. So this is another example of the end of the church age. Another example. There's no such thing as indulgences. We're inherently free. You don't purchase your freedom. You can't purchase your freedom. We're created free. And what God created can never be changed in any way. So we are free. We're free right now. We've always been free. We've just been under this delusion that we're trying to be the ones that establish this freedom for ourselves. We want to establish a freedom for ourselves instead of accepting the fact that God established it for us. This is called spiritual arrogance. So the new challenge is to finish and this acceptance and experience this flatness, as it were. This is part of the experiencing of liberation. You need to experience your liberation from delusion, from arrogance. So now I'm just someone that, you know, was aware that Jesus was going to come back and bring this new dispensation, this new challenge. I was aware of it before I came back to this world again. Been here many times. And of course, Jesus is, quote unquote, in the afterlife, is present. You can easily, more present, we're more easy to relate. And so I became aware of relating with Jesus in the afterlife, that there was, he was coming back, and he challenged me, saying, would you like to take this new challenge? I have a new challenge. Are you interested? And I said, yes, absolutely, I'm interested. Because it's very likely, I'm thinking about my previous lives. I've had many, I think about 32 previous lives. It's very likely that I had previous lives as a Jew and part of the Judeo-Christian traditions, quite very likely. Maybe some incarnations also in the Vedic culture of India, the Vedic culture, because I do have understanding and appreciation of Hinduism and Buddhism, very much so. But certainly I feel I had lives in ancient Jewish, you know, tradition, being very, very disciplined under the law. And through that sort of discipline, that I probably played some role in the church, the Christian church. And I know my previous life to this, I was someone who tried to support Christian culture through producing what I felt was very high sacred music. And I was extremely disciplined. And people said I could accomplish in 1 year, or someone said a day, but 1 year, I could accomplish in a year what other people took a lifetime to accomplish. Some say even a day, I could accomplish in 1 day what people couldn't accomplish in a lifetime, because I was so disciplined, and I could create very fast and disciplined way, and had a lifetime of extreme discipline trying to support Christianity through, say, great music, composing great music. But it was still mixed. It was still mixed with arrogance, absolutely. I don't even think the music was that good, but people at that time did. Looking back on it, you know, I'd say, oh, you know, I could do a lot better now. But it was good for the time. It was good for the time. And I tried to keep the spirit of the Holy Roman Empire, the spirit of Europe. I tried to keep that. I was trying to keep that spirit going. Keep it going. Keep the challenge going. Let's not quit on the challenge, because there were those who did quit on the challenge a lot, and they lapsed into what I call modernism. I was opposed to modernism. I said that's lapsing, that's quitting on the challenge that Jesus gave us. It's quitting on it. I was very adamant about this. I actually was one of the most outspoken leaders of maintaining the challenge as best I could. It was still a mixed message looking back on it. Yeah, absolutely. But I did the best I could. And I was adamantly opposed to modernism, which I saw as giving up, quitting the challenge, saying, ah, I can't do it. I said, no, don't quit. Stay disciplined. Keep working at it. You know, you can't quit. So I was very adamant about that. And so Jesus then asked me in the afterlife, you know, would you like to be part of this new challenge? I'm coming back and I need some help. Would you like to accept this new challenge and help out? And I said, yes, I would. Because I don't want to quit. I believe, and Jesus says, don't quit. You can do it. You can do it. I'm going to help you do it. So he told me before I came back into this world, he told me, I'm going to help you do it because I'm going to provide some curriculum, some teachings for you that are going to help you succeed. So I knew that Jesus was going to provide some curriculum for us here in the world, in my generation, for sure. I was absolutely positive of it. He absolutely promised me this. So I came back to this world. Didn't want to really come back. Who wants to come back to this world? But I said, okay, because I do have to finish. I have to finish, so might as well get after it. Came back to the world. I knew that there was going to be this tremendous book published somewhere, curriculum, with this tremendous teachings of Jesus. I knew it. So when everybody was telling me, oh, we can't make it, we can't make it, I told them, yes, you can, yes, you can, yes, you can. Don't give up, don't give up. When I was young, I was very adamant, don't give up. And keep in mind that I have practice of being very adamant and disciplined. And previously in Europe, I was one of the leading voices opposing modernism. I got tremendous grief for this. I got tremendously attacked for it. But nobody could push me around. Nobody. And so Jesus knew that I could come back and speak about this, and I would be, I wouldn't be able to be pushed around so easily. So. It's true, but I still got bullied here, because modernism is quite a bully, actually. Very arrogant. I underestimated the arrogance of the times. You see, back in Europe at that time, which was the 19th century, I was in Europe, there was still a lot of Christian momentum, you see, in Europe and around the world. So they weren't so arrogant, and I could speak up, and people would listen, and they would say, hey, maybe he's right. Maybe he's right. Maybe we shouldn't quit. Whereas, so I thought, oh, I can come back. It's not going to be a problem. Well, I came back. The modernism had taken root, this vile cancer of modernism, which is really secular humanism, which is really quitting the challenge, saying, I can't do it, quitting it, had become so strong that I could speak up, and wow, I got backlash, a very severe backlash. And I was very surprised about this. I was taken aback. I was shocked by it, very shocked by it. So it wasn't as easy as I thought. In fact, it became extremely difficult. And basically, people just ignored me. Says, who is this idiot? Not going to pay attention to him. We know we can't succeed. Who is this knucklehead to tell us that we can't succeed and that Jesus is coming back and that's going to have a great teaching? This guy's just, he's stupid. Who wants to listen to this idiot? And so they just ignored me, which I was not used to being ignored. That is for sure. And because I was used to having, a whole continent listen to me, I was used to having a very strong authoritative voice, and now everyone was just ignoring me. So I didn't know what to do. I said, wow, this is crazy. I can't cope with this. It's really terrible. And of course, most of the world is still ignoring me at this time. Modernism has gotten into everybody so severely that they just ignore it. Arrogance tells them, I just ignore these fools. You know you can't succeed. Arrogance is the way, they say. Arrogance says, arrogance is the way. And Jesus was just, some sort of, actually he just came to bring socialism or communism to the world. That's all he was about. So they don't listen. They still don't listen. But it doesn't bother me as much anymore. It still bothers me, but not as much. So lo and behold, in 1978, I was been searching. Where is that? Where Jesus promised me, what he promised me. And I said, I need it. Help. And I still couldn't find it. I said, my gosh, what he promised? And then I found it. A Course in Miracles. And I knew right away when I started to study it. I said, this is what Jesus promised me. Absolutely knew it for sure. 100% for sure. And I said, okay, it's go time. He is coming back. Everything, all the plan is working. He didn't give up on it. He didn't look at modernism and say, oh my gosh, I can't come back to this. It's going to be too difficult, But I couldn't imagine Jesus saying it's too difficult. He already came 2,020 years ago. If you feel, around 2,020 years, you're born 6 BC or 4 BC, somewhere between then, sometime in that time frame. If he came into the world then with it so difficult, how could he say it's too difficult to return now? I said, no, he's not going to quit. I don't think he's going to quit. So when I found A Course in Miracles, I realized, Jesus is not going to quit. He's not going to be a no-show Jones. He's going to come back. Even though the whole world we'll try to ignore him and say, oh no, that's ridiculous. He's going to come back. He's not going to quit on his word, his promise. No way. No way. So I got into practicing this study in Course in Miracles and realizing, you know, I had to practice. I had to finish, you know, the challenge that Jesus gives us is to finish now. And I have the work of being someone who speaks up about this, okay, which I've been doing here on YouTube. Anyone in the world can view these videos, okay? Very difficult thing to do. I'm not hiding in secret somewhere, you know, some secret society hiding somewhere as far as what I'm saying. These videos are public. Anyone in the world can watch them. Okay, that's the pressure I've been under. And so I'm willing to say, Jesus asked me, are you willing to affirm the truth that I'm coming back and now I am back, and this of course in miracles was my work by me in Journey Beyond Words, the other voice that was my curriculum, that it is my teaching, this is my help for you, and now I'm coming back to give you even more boost and relate with you and tell you, yes, this is the challenge now is practice. Are you willing to say that? And obviously I have said this, so I did it. I was willing to do it, and I have done it. But it certainly has not been easy, this age of secular humanistic materialism, age of arrogance, you might call it, is quite a beast, quite a bully. And if you're feeling, you know, bullied by it, intimidated, well, you know, join the club, right? I only know that I'm not intimidated enough to be quiet about it, you know. I'm still saying what needs to be said. But yeah. It's a real beast, isn't it? It's a monster. It's an absolute monster. They keep putting out these movies and video games and stuff with these huge, vicious reptiles, Tyrannosaurus Rex-like vehicle. And now they're even putting wings on them. They're flying wherever you are. They're biting you in two, you know. That's arrogance saying, you better shut up. You better shut up or we're going to bite you in two. You know, arrogance trying to intimidate us here. To intimidate Christians, all those who take up the challenge by whatever name you want to call yourself. Okay, I'm not excluding any religious people at all around the world. It's just for sake of speaking of it, streamlining it, you know, the challenge for all of us, actually, is to recognize that we are equal with God, but we didn't establish our equality. God did. That is the essential truth that we need to accept, which is essentially dropping arrogance entirely. We have to finish this. So, arrogance is trying to intimidate us all by these movies and television programs and all of this, right? Constantly. I'm watching like this basketball game last night. Cleveland and Atlanta. And these commercials come on, you know, it's like, and this has been going on for years and years and years and years. Actually, this whole effort to intimidate us with reptiles, big reptiles, has been going on for maybe about 30 years or more now. And I was very aware of it when it started. I said, whoa, what is this? There's an obsession with dinosaurs and actually reptiles, big ones. And they were trying to figure out, how do we invent these video games so we can intimidate everybody here? And they're, you know, the tech people are trying to figure it out. Now they've figured it out pretty good, right? And so now you have all these video games and movies where these massive jaws, you know, hideous reptiles flying, chasing you, grabbing you, you know. Then they're in the cities, they're chasing you everywhere, and everyone's screaming and running from them, and they're grabbing people and eating them, and you know, it's just like people, you know, this is what they were aiming at. This is what all these tech people, you know, came here basically, a lot of them, to work on this games, video games, and movies with, you know, CGI, computer generated imagery, computer generated imagery, CGI. That's what they were working on, to scare us, to intimidate us, saying if you don't follow arrogance, this is what's going to happen to you. This is how you're going to be punished if you don't follow arrogance. So of course there's a lot of intimidation going on here. I mean, they've done their very best to intimidate us, you know, yet we're still laughing. We're laughing, aren't we? We're laughing at it. We won't be intimidated. And we will not accept any compromise between arrogance and the Holy Spirit. We will not accept any compromise, because there is no compromise. Either God created us equal with God, or God didn't. It's one or the other. There's no in-between whatsoever. There's no in-between. Either it is or it isn't. Either God created us equal with God, as equal, or God did not create us as equal. It's one or the other. There's no compromise between those. It's one or the other. So, the Holy Spirit knows this. Holy Spirit knows this. And Jesus knows this. So, Jesus has returned to this world. And how do I know? Because my attention was willing to accept this. Because Jesus, what I experienced was Jesus put out this call and said, "Hey, everyone, I'm back." To everyone in the world, "Everyone, I am back." And since I was willing to hear this and my attention was willing to look at this, I heard it and I say, wow. I became aware that indeed Jesus is back. It's true. And he said, "I'm here to relate with everyone here who wants to relate with me as a friend, as an equal." Okay? I'm here to relate as a friend, as an equal. And how do we do that? We have to realize that we're equal to God. Because obviously Jesus knows he's equal with God, right? That's why people call him the Son of God. Son of God is what? Equal with God. The Son is the same as the Father, except the Son did not establish his sonship. The Father did. The Father created the Son. The Son did not create the Father, right? That's the only difference. And this is what Jesus tells us in his more modern curriculum that's for his door, this new dispensation. He's telling this, yeah, that's it. God created the Son. The Son didn't create the Father. Other than that, they're equal. Equal. So how do we relate with Jesus as an equal, as a friend? How do we relate with Jesus as a friend, as an equal? Well, we have to realize that we're equal with God. We have to. And that we didn't establish this equality. God did from the very beginning. From the very beginning. We didn't earn it. There's no way you can earn this. Again, our salvation is through grace, plain and simple. 100%. 100%. There isn't this compromise. But in the age of consideration, the church age, it was a maybe thing. So that's fine. I mean, Catholic Church, it's teaching a compromise. It says maybe this, maybe that. Maybe it's both. Maybe it's both. Maybe it's this, maybe it's that, maybe it's both. Consider this, consider it, consider. So it's kind of funny. You get some teachings of truth, like they teach St. Paul and telling you this by grace, it's grace, and then they say, but you need to go out and do charitable works, otherwise you can't be saved, this is very important. And, so they're teaching both salvation through grace and works. And sometimes they lean this way, and sometimes they lean that way. And so that's part of the age of consideration. But there's a new dispensation now. And this is the deciding which is it. And Jesus tells us, unequivocally, it's through grace entirely. We were created equal to God, and there's absolutely nothing we can do to establish that, nor is there anything we can do to disestablish it. Okay? There's absolutely nothing we can do to establish it, and there's nothing we can do to disestablish it. We are that because the will of God is that we are equal with God. The Son of God's Spirit is equal with God. The same, equal. But we didn't establish that, okay? Little coast here. We've been doing some acceleration here. Not too fast. We've been going fast, but we haven't been doing assertions. That's where it gets real fast. We can do assertions when I feel like if we can do that. Yes, I already know that what arrogance has been telling me has depth is actually totally flat. Yes, I'm already experiencing that everything arrogance told me has depth to it. Actually, it's totally flat. Totally flat. All lies are equally lies. There's no depth to lies whatsoever. There's no depth to lies whatsoever. None. Zero. Yes, I already know that. I'm already experiencing that there's no depth to lies whatsoever. See, this is an assertion. This is in the form of already. This is one of the forms of assertion, a very powerful form. Yes, I already know that I am already experiencing that there's absolutely no depth of lies whatsoever. Never has been and never will be. It's a fantasy. Seeing depth in lies is nothing but a hallucination. A fantasy hallucination. So I'm just seeing what's always been. So it's always been completely flat. There's nothing to it. There's nothing to lies. Completely flat, all equally meaningless. All equally meaningless. No exception to truth whatsoever. So you see, this is more in assertion mode, and I can feel the wow, the acceleration here. You can feel it. Feel the acceleration, spiritual acceleration. How are we doing here? Very good. Very great. So speaking out adamantly about very important Christian issues is something I've done before. So that's why I'm able to do it now. And of course, arrogance will say, "Who is that guy? He's so arrogant. Who does he think he is saying this stuff? You know, that kind of stuff." You know, of course, arrogance will say that about everybody, except its own chosen spokespeople, who are will teach a mixed message to you. Teach a mixed message to you. We'll say, no, really, go back to consideration. It works. This is very important. Yeah, it'll pick its spokesperson to say they're the ones who you got to listen to. They're the ones that arrogance has anointed. That's what arrogance will say. The arrogance has anointed these to be the spokespersons to talk about Christianity, talk about Jesus, that kind of situation. Well, who is trying to reach me now? Uh-oh. One moment.
Yes.
All right, little emergency there. Everything's fine. Okay. So, again, who are you? Who am I to speak up? That's what arrogance will say. Who is this? Who is this person? I would just ignore him, ignore him. Arrogance will say, I didn't anoint this one. I did not anoint them. Who are they to be speaking up now? Well, Jesus asked me to speak up. That's why I'm speaking up. I didn't ask arrogance for permission to, I didn't ask for any anointing from arrogance, okay? Now, arrogance tried to anoint me, but it insisted I teach a mixed message, okay? It insisted I teach a compromise. And I said, no. Arrogance actually told me if I would accept the anointing of arrogance, that I would have a massive audience, which is probably true. And I rejected it. So here I am with just a very small, group here listening. But it's a true message. It's not a mixed message here. And I do, I do have to be very careful not to be too feisty to these people, arrogant ones, and that's why, one of the reasons why I probably was a Jew, had a Jewish lives, in ancient times and maybe less ancient times, because Jews can be quite feisty and very adamant, if you tell them, tell them they're wrong. You know, they can be very feisty about it. And so I have, you know, I have that capacity to be, you know, just absolutely devastate, you know, if I became very, very feisty about it. So I have to watch that and not do that. So I have to be very gracious and forgiving, you know, to everyone, which is right. You know, that is, it is the right way. But still keep the adamant, you know, be adamant and speak the truth. You know, we don't want to scare people away and intimidate them away. We want them to come back and take up this challenge, a new challenge. So if you've lapsed, you know, welcome back, but not into the consideration, into practice. Okay, welcome back into practice. And again, you can be lapsed from any religion, actually, any teaching. Welcome back to practice. The new dispensation is a global dispensation. It's practicing right practice and finish this spiritual consideration, this path of consideration we've been upon. It's for everyone, actually. You can say, well, you're a Buddhist, I'm a Buddhist and I'm taking up the challenge of Jesus, this new challenge. That's fine. You can be a Buddhist and take up the challenge. You can be a Hindu, take up the challenge. You can be any group you want to. Take up the challenge, this new challenge that Jesus is bringing now. Not a problem. It'll work for you too. It'll work for you too. Truth works for everyone. Truth is true for everyone. There's no exception to truth. Lies are flat for everyone. Lies are equally flat for everyone. Okay? Lies are all equally meaningless for lies are equally meaningless for everyone. Truth is equally true for everyone. Doesn't matter how you label your path and your effort, what label you apply to it. It doesn't change truth at all, right? It's not like truth is true for us because we're the ones who know the truth and truth is not true for the others. No, truth is true for everyone. God created spirit. Spirit is one family. God created the one family of spirit as equal to God. But spirit did not establish its equality. God did. Okay. So all spirit is equal with God. It's all one. One equality with God. There's no difference in it. There's not some that are more equal and some that are less equal. No, all equally equal. This is Jesus' message. All equally equal. Yes, I already know we are all equally equal. And I actually had an experience where I saw that. I experienced it. I realized and saw that everyone here in this world and throughout the cosmos, we're all spirit is equal with God. We're all equal. One family of perfect equality. I experienced this, and that's the greatest experience I've ever had, for sure. And I realized that's what I really want. You know, this is it. That's it. That's the goal. Not equal in the flesh. That's not our goal. Not equal through works. No, equal through grace, through inherent grace, through inherent equality. It's always been that way. It's never changed in any way whatsoever. And there's nothing we need to do to make it that way. We don't need some equalitarian social structures, etc., etc. No. That's arrogance advising that. Because that's avoiding spiritual realization. Okay? That's trying to make it flesh realization. Trying to earn equality. Trying to establish equality. Okay? All these attempts to establish equality, that's arrogance. Jesus says, practice spiritual practice and you will realize that we are all equal and have always been equal and always will be spiritually equal. We're not bodies at all. But all these bodies, everything we've imagined in this dream is flat, equally flat. The good, the bad, and the ugly, the supposed higher and the lower, whatever, the rich and the poor, everything completely flat with no depth to any of it whatsoever. Has no effect on our equality with God. Nothing does. The dream has had absolutely no effect on our equality with God, this whole dream of time, space, process, and form. So arrogance is trying to say, yeah, we have something similar, you know. Let's work for social equality, social justice, all this stuff. We have, you know, arrogance is always trying to say that it's similar. Lies are never similar to truth. You can dress them up to make them look similar. You can dress them up. You can put lipstick on the pig, you know, but, you know, that's all it is. It's still a pig with lipstick on it. It still lies. It's still the attempt to establish our equality with God. It is still an attempt to do it through good works, whether it be social justice works, equality works in this world, trying to work for all these equality in this world. Those are still works. It is still trying to establish our equality with God through good works. And that is arrogance. That is a lie. That is deception. From the standpoint of God, there's no such thing as good works. No such thing as good works. Because that's sheer arrogance. Who is it that needs good works to establish their equality with God? Who is it? Did Jesus go to some and say, wow, you're more righteous than others? No, he said, God loves all equally. Right now, all are equal in the eyes of God right now. So arrogance is busy at work in this world trying to deceive everybody, and it seems quite deceptive. But when you hear the truth, then you realize, ah, this is true. This is true. Let's do it this way. Let's practice in the right way here. But don't struggle too much with what's taking place in the world. Just don't pay attention to it, really. Okay? Just have faith that this is the way that works, that spiritual practice is the way that works now. Have faith in that. That the age of consideration is over. And what arrogance is really leading us to is a dead end of tyranny, severe tyranny. Arrogance is constantly flying under the banner of equality, insisting it's going for equality. It's really going for tyranny. Equality is just a code word for tyranny, actually, for enslavement. It's just the code word they're using. That's what arrogance uses, this code word of equality. It's really pushing tyranny. Okay. Equality is never of the flesh. It's always of the spirit. The dream of the flesh is never equal, because it doesn't work. And arrogance is always advising winning and domination, actually. But it can't come right out and say, hey, my advice is domination. It says, oh, no, I'm working towards equality here. It's working towards domination, as always. Now, the great middle class in this country, the United States, and around the world, was made up of those, mostly of people of faith, okay, who had taken up the challenge, and they said, hey, we don't want to be real rich, and we don't want to be poor, we don't want to try to get it through pity or through winning. It's not about winning, and it's not about losing. It's not about winning, and it's not about losing. So what's it about? So we've kind of taken this middle path, you know, middle path, let's avoid extremes here. You know, so, but now the middle class is getting wiped out. It's getting wiped out by winning and losing, the ideology of winning and losing, this dualistic strategy of winning and losing. Okay. Okay, so it's getting wiped out by that, and that's a big problem. It's a big problem. So, and so a lot of people are now saying that we can't have any losers. You know, we can't have any losers. Get rid of the losers. Get rid of the winners. We can't have any losers. But they don't understand that the logic of arrogance inherently pressures you into winning. And but they don't see it that way. They say, no. We just have to control everybody and have complete control of everybody's lives in order to take care of these losers here. But what they don't understand, that power corrupts. severely. The more power you get, the more arrogance tells you, hey, you know, you're almost there. Just do this. You're almost there. Just do this. And you become tyrants. Become tyranny. 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 We should have already known this, you know, throughout history. It's completely obvious. Everybody, all tyrants become tyrants through pretending to champion the losers of the world, right? That's how they become tyrants. Did they just institute severe tyranny and control? You know, duh. You know, this is history. This is history 101, right? And it's the same old. Arrogance never changed its tune, really. The same old tune. It, you know, it's the same old skeleton. It just puts different dresses on, different clothing on the skeleton. Sometimes the skeleton, you know, arrogance puts a pants on the skeleton. Sometimes it puts a dress on the skeleton. You know, same old song, same old skeleton. Same old failed advice, same old dead end. So don't struggle with this all, you know. I feel, oh boy, that's a headache, you know, it's a headache. Just practice, spiritual practice. Just practice, just assert. Just practice, folks, walk together in the wow. Accelerate, coast. Keep flipping the script like what we're doing here. Realize that you can accept the truth. And that practice does succeed. Okay? If you've been lapsed, welcome back. Welcome back. Don't be afraid of Jesus at all. He's not coming to judge or condemn. That was part of the ambivalence that we had before. That's the old belief in the law. That we, you know, since it was a period of consideration, we were maybe-ness. So maybe it's the law, maybe it's not. Maybe it's the law, maybe it's grace. Maybe it's the law, maybe it's grace. And so we still have those elements of believing that Jesus is going to come back and he's going to judge everybody and condemn those who don't follow, accept him to everlasting hellfire, you know, and all this kind of stuff, yeah. Now that's what arrogance will do to you, you know. So that's not Jesus at all. There's no condemnation in Jesus at all. None. I would have felt it. In my visits with him, I would have felt it. There's no condemnation. There's just good humor. Relaxed, calm, not a control freak, at peace, a friend, an equal, a friend. No arrogance, no attack, no judgment, none of that. Just like you feel like he's your best friend. Like, wow, what a great friend. You know, what a great friend we have in Jesus. What a great friend. So, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to succeed. Don't be afraid to succeed. Now, there's no pressure in terms of you have to relate or something. I don't know. I don't know how that's going to go at all. To me, it doesn't matter so much. It's finishing that matters. I mean, it's accepting the truth that matters. It's setting arrogance down that matters. It's being liberated from fear that matters. That's what matters. That's what's so important. And then we'll naturally be able to relate to everyone as equals. We'll naturally be able to relate to Jesus as not a problem at all. Won't be a problem at all. So just keep working on this spiritual practice. That is what is important right now. Again, this is the new age of spiritual practice. Right? Spiritual practice. This is the new age. We're in it. The new dispensation. Spiritual practice is the new dispensation. So be there or be enslaved, basically. Be there or be enslaved. Now a lot of people, a lot of Christians and are saying, well, we're not gonna be enslaved, we're gonna fight. Well, what they're saying is, wow, you know, we're gonna free ourselves from enslavement, because we're already enslaved here. The arrogance is already here, and it's a enslavement mindset. And they say, well, we're going to fight against this. Well, you know, slaves can rise up in rebellion, but what happens to them, right? You need to accept the fact that it's impossible for you to be a slave. You're free. You're liberated. You're liberated from arrogance. You can't be touched. This is what you have to realize. Jesus told us, resist not evil. Turn the other cheek. Love your enemy. See? Because it says we don't need to fight. We're free. We cannot be enslaved. We're free. So practice accepting your freedom. You're perfectly free, except you did not establish your freedom. You're perfect. We're all perfectly free, but we didn't establish our freedom. God did. That's it. Just practice that. Yes, I already know that I am perfectly free. And it's just that I didn't establish my freedom. I know that I didn't establish my freedom. God did. So yes, I already know that I am already perfectly free. And God did not establish my freedom. God did. So yes, I already know that I'm already perfectly free. And I didn't establish my freedom. God did. Yes, I already know. Yes, I'm already experiencing my perfect freedom. Because I know I didn't establish my freedom. God did. Yes, I am already experiencing my perfect freedom. Because I know I didn't establish my perfect freedom. God did. Yes, I already know that I am already experiencing my perfect freedom. Because I know I didn't establish my perfect freedom. God did. Okay, these are assertions again. So assert as if it's true, as if you are experiencing this. You're embracing this. You're saying you're all in. You're buying into this. You're buying into it entirely. All the chips are on the table now, okay? Yes, I already know that I am already experiencing my perfect freedom. Because I know I didn't establish my perfect freedom. God did. Yes, I already know that I'm already experiencing my perfect equality with God. Because I know I didn't establish my perfect equality with God. God did. Now as you practice this, you may feel some feeling sort of creep up on you. And this is the wow feeling. Could you say, wow, I'm not really in consideration mode anymore, am I? I'm not in Kansas anymore here. This is stronger. This is a whole different ballgame here, actually. This isn't just spinning my wheels in consideration. This is entering into the truth of my being right now. So you're going to feel this wow creeping up on you. So this is why you have to be aware of this. Not paranoid about it. It's not like if you don't stop at exactly right instant, you're going to fry, you're going to be cast into hell or something. It's not like that. It's just that you're just aware, oh, okay, I can feel this. Wow. Let me coast for a little bit. That's all. Let me coast for just a little bit. Be cautious. Be preemptively cautious with this. Because this is very potent. So we don't spend all our time railing against the world and arrogance, how terrible. We spend a lot of time practicing, for sure. Very important. And a very potent way of practicing is use this already form. It's the most potent way, actually, there is. Yes, I already know that there's absolutely nothing I can do to establish my equality with God. And I don't need to do anything. I already know I don't need to do anything because God established my equality with God. Yes, I already know that there's absolutely nothing I can do to establish my equality with God because I was created equal with God. Yes, I already know that there's absolutely nothing I can do to establish my equality with God because I was created equal. Because God created me equal with God. Yes, I already know there's absolutely nothing I can ever do to establish my equality with God because I already know that God created me equal with God. And see, I'm feeling very strong wow feeling from this. Stronger than any other part in this video. This hits hard. Yes, I already know that I am already experiencing my perfect equality with God because I already know that I didn't establish my perfect equality with God. God created me equal with God. The short form would be, yes, I already know that I'm already experiencing my perfect equality with God because I already know that God created me perfectly equal with God. Okay, that's the streamlined version. Yes, I already know that I'm already experiencing my perfect equality with God because I already know that God created me perfectly equal with God. God created my perfect equality with God. So yes, I already know that I'm already experiencing my perfect equality with God because I already know that God created my perfect equality with God. There we go again. Okay, one moment. People are getting a little pushy, but that's what happens, okay? So it's all right. If you're forced into a little emergency situation, okay, right back with it. So yes, I already know that I'm already experiencing my perfect equality with God because I already know that God created my perfect equality with God. Yes, I already know that I'm already experiencing my perfect equality with God because I already know that God created my perfect equality with God. This is right spiritual practice. This is the practice from the new dispensation here of finishing our consideration. This is effective spiritual practice for the new dispensation. Yes, I already know that I am already experiencing my perfect equality with God because I already know that God created my perfect equality with God. And I don't need to do anything to establish it. I don't need to do anything to establish it. In fact, there's nothing I can do to establish it. I already know that there's absolutely nothing I can do to establish my perfect equality with God because I already know that God created my perfect equality with God. I already know that there's absolutely nothing I can ever do that in any way can ever establish my perfect equality with God because I already know that God created my perfect equality with God. Now, am I worried if Jesus comes back here today and says, hey, hello, walks up the path? I'd say, how you doing? I say, well, I'm practicing like you told me to practice. So it's kind of like, you know, if your teacher comes and you're doing your homework, you know, you're not nervous. You say, you're doing your work? Yeah. How you doing? I'm doing really good at it. Okay, so okay, good, good, good. Yeah, but if you're playing hooky, you know, and the teacher's looking for you, you know, okay, who's in class here? You know, and you're gone. Say, where is so and so? And you know, it's a different story. But if you're there doing what you've been told to do, advised to do, doing it, why should you worry? Well, you know, what worry do I have? I'm doing what I've been advised to do. So, I'm not concerned. Jesus show up right now and say, hey, hi. Yeah. I just nod and say, I wouldn't be all freaked out and nervous. I'd say, he obviously has to know that I'm doing the work that I was advised to do. I know I'm doing it. So I got no guilty conscience or anything. I'm not some slacker who's faking it or something. I'm not faking, I'm doing it. So again, yes, I already know that there's absolutely nothing I can ever do in any way to ever establish my equality with God, because I already know that God created my equality with God. And if Jesus was here right now, I wouldn't freak out, because I know he's not going to ask me to try to do anything to establish my equality with God. I don't have to worship Jesus. I don't have to idolize Jesus. I don't have to go run out and do some good works. I don't have to. He'd say, hey, great, you're practicing as I told you to. That's wonderful. Keep doing it. It's going to succeed for you for sure. And since I'm already doing it, why should I get nervous or worried? I said, I'm already doing it, and I'm not getting, it's not difficult for me. So he's not going to demand I do something really difficult. He'll just say, hey, keep doing it. Good work. Keep doing it. So you know, why should I be afraid? Yes, I already know that there's absolutely nothing I can ever do to ever establish my equality with God, because I already know that God created me. My equality with God. End of story. Right? How are we doing on the time? Well, we're getting up there, right? We're getting up there. Yes, I already know that I'm already experiencing my perfect equality with God, because I already know that God created my perfect equality with God. Yes, I already know that I'm already experiencing my perfect equality with God, because I already know that God created my perfect equality with God. So, right? It has to be here now, right? It can't be in time, can it? It can't be in some location, can it? It can't be in some thing, can it? Because it's from the very beginning. It's from my very creation. I was created equal. So it can't be in time, space, process, and form. It can't be there. It has to be right here, right now. It has to be nowhere, so to speak. No thing, nowhere, no time. Yes, I already know that I already know that I'm nothing, that I'm nowhere, that I'm never. See, that was just from the very beginning, is everywhere. It cannot be said to be somewhere. It's everywhere. It cannot be said to be some location. It's everywhere. It cannot be said to be some time. It's eternal. It's always. It cannot be said to be something. It's everything. It's allness. It's allness. It's allness. So, yes, I already know that I'm nothing. I'm never. I'm nothing, I'm nowhere. Yes, I already know that I'm absolutely nowhere, I'm absolutely nothing, I'm absolutely never. yes, I already know that I'm absolutely nowhere. I'm absolutely nothing. I'm absolutely never. And then you could say, yes, I already know that I'm absolutely everywhere. I'm absolutely everything. I'm absolutely always. Try to keep your body still. Don't try to move your body in any rhythmic way, okay? Don't tap your feet rhythmically. Don't beat out a drum beat with your feet. Keep your hands to hands. Don't scratch. Don't itch. Don't play with your hair, your appearance, or anything. Keep your hands to your hands. Sit still quietly. Don't be trying to move your body in some rhythmic way. Yeah, you might move back to ease the... You know, back is stiff, you know, move a little bit like that, this way. Don't slouch though, don't be goofy, don't slouch, you know, so just remain resolute like this, remain poised. Why did Jesus teach in the synagogues? And He observed a lot of the Jewish ritual purity laws, etc., and all this. Well, he was saying, look, I respect everything you've done. I respect your efforts. I respect your discipline. That's a good thing. Don't get rid of it. Don't hate yourself. The reason why it hasn't worked is not for lack of effort on your part and discipline. It's because arrogance is meaningless. It's meaningless. That's why it hasn't worked. It's nothing. But it's nothing. It's a empty, meaningless, nothing lie. Okay, that's why it hasn't worked. You cannot change reality. You cannot change reality. What God has created cannot be changed. And so he's saying, look, I'm showing respect. I respect you. I respect all the efforts you've made. So keep that going. Keep your discipline going. Except now turn your discipline towards considering grace, that your salvation is through grace and not through the law. That's all he was saying. Start this consideration. So sure, he agreed and went along with a lot of the Jewish teachings, etc. He was showing respect. Showing respect for him. And he gave out parables. He said a lot of people won't understand what I'm getting at here. But he interacted. He mingled. He showed respect for the traditions. Not all of it. Because he said, look, I'm bringing a new dispensation here. But I don't want you to attack yourself for your failures. Use your discipline now in a new way, in a new direction. Use your discipline, use your determination, use your poise, use your capacity. Use your capacity to be focused for a long period of time, to be silent, to be quiet. Use your capacity like this. Use it now to consider that your salvation is through grace. Use it. So he respected just now, like for now. I try to show respect for, you know, the age of consideration. I show respect. I still go to church, you know. I'm there showing respect for it. Of course, I understand it's teaching a mixed message. I understand we need to go into this new dispensation, but I'm showing it respect. Absolutely. Show the culture respect. You know, we don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. All the efforts to go to church, to be disciplined, to be super modest. By the way, one way you can tell that the church age has ended, there's so many little things creeping into the Catholic Church now that I'm noticing. It's like, wow. It's turning into a mother religion, basically. It's turning into paganism, heathenism. It's following the ways of arrogance. As I've said, ultimately they'll turn churches into fashion shows. You know, let's go, hey, go to church and watch a fashion show of new haute couture. You know, these are the latest fashions, and there'll be music and bands and drink, and you know, they'll turn their turn the church into a carnival inside. For sure they will. And you know, you can see it creeping up all the time, creeping up, creeping up, creeping up. When the priest, who's a very, very learned and excellent priest, started our Father prayer, which Jesus gave us, our Father out in heaven, hallowed be your name, he said, Hail Mary, to start it out. And he said, oops, like you're shocked, like, why did I say that? And I said, wow. And then he wore the priestly vestments with the Virgin of Guadalupe on it. Does that quite a bit now, yeah. And goddess worship is creeping into the church very strongly. So, when there's a procession that comes at the beginning of Mass to the altar, and there's the altar boys. A lot of times they're altar girls now. And they bring up the candles, and they bring up the various stuff that they need, you know, in the procession. And then there's someone carrying the Holy Bible, okay? And they come up to the altar, go around and set the Holy Bible on the altar there, in its holder there, book holder. Okay, that's a very important function to do. And it's usually young people that are doing this, young people, okay? This is a procession as the priest walks up the aisle. This is a very solemn moment. But what this is supposed to do is set the tone for the Mass, and that we're here, you know, to crucify the flesh. We're here to consider Jesus' words very seriously, very seriously. So the tone that they're setting there is very important. So what do we get? What are we getting now in this procession? Well, I noticed something very surprising. It's not the first time I've noticed it at all, but this time it seemed to be stronger than ever. And it was this young girl, not that young, I don't know how old, but maybe 11, 12 or something. And she was wearing a skimpy summer dress, very colorful, you know, with sort of a bare shoulders, bare arms, you know, a lot of bare skin, short skirt. Type of a dress, short dress, summer dress, spring summer dress, very colorful, and you know,